going to share the screen. Students, are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
But I finish all these things. So now I am going to this right upper quadrant page. That is what today I am going to talk. Okay, now it's all case scenario, because yesterday I talked about what is abdominal pain, what are the various quadrants, everything we finished already. And we finished acute right lower quadrant pain. Today we are going to discuss two case scenarios on right upper quadrant pain. I hope that all of you might have gone through these slides already and watched the videos as well. So I expect you to answer. Okay, who is the first person? You can read this case scenario. Priveena Rajan. Priveena Rajan, yes. It is group D1. Yeah, can you please read this one?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
A 40-year-old moderately obese female present to the emergency department with a one-day history of constant epigastric and right upper quadrant pain. She described the severity of the pain as a 7 out of 10. The pain began after eating fried pork. She reported that the pain also seems to affect the right side of her back near her scapula. She feels nauseated as vomited twice. She had similar pain but of lesser severity about once a month for the past year. The pain comes on after eating fried or spicy food, but previously it has resolved after an hour. She's Gravida 6 and Para 6.
Okay, now wait. The pain is going to the back near to the scapula. What is that sign called?
Radiation.
Yeah, radiation to the scapula. What is that sign?
Bova sign.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, that's what I want. And then pain is coming after. So this is not. This is for both biliary colic and this one. And they are telling it is constant epigastric pain. Previously, okay, the patient has got similar previous episode after eating the spicy food or the fatty food, but it resolved after an hour. So what was that previous?
Previous,
yeah, that is biliary colic. So in acute colic studies, pain will last for how many hours?
Persistent.
How many hours it will last? Pain.
More than four hours.
Yeah. Usually it is constant. Okay, can you continue, Priveena? Can you read
this, sir, also?
Yeah, please.
On physical examination, her temperature was 100 Fahrenheit, heart rate is 110 per minute, and her blood pressure is 120 per 80 millimeter mercury. She has marked tenderness in the right upper quadrant of the abdomen to palpation. When the right upper quadrant is palpated, while she's taking a deep breath, she abruptly ceases inspiration secondary to pain. This is called as Murphy's sign positive.
Laboratory, so what is this called? What is this called? She stops breathing. So what is this called? I told one more word for this. She stops inspiration. What is that called? Inspiratory? I told some particular
words.
Inspiratory what? Yes.
Inspiratory catch.
Yeah, that is correct. Priveena, continue this. Continue reading this.
Laboratory values are significant for a white blood cell count of 14,000.
Yeah, leave this. 14,000. Yeah. Bilirubin, 1 milligram. Yeah. Alkaline phosphatase.
70 units per liter, amylase was 60 units per liter, and lipase was 30 units per liter.
Okay. Amylase, lipase, alkaline phosphatase, bilirubin, everything is normal except WBC is increased. All other things are normal. What is your differential diagnosis, Privina? If it is right upper quadrant pain, first tell me what are the organs lying in this quadrant, right upper quadrant?
Liver.
Liver, okay. Right lobe of liver. Then what else?
Gallbladder.
Gallbladder, liver, gallbladder. Anything else?
Right kidney.
Right kidney, upper pole of right kidney. Anything else? Any intestine?
Transverse
colon. No, hepatic flexor may be part of the transverse colon. Okay, agree. So these are the organs. Any pathology in these things can produce acute right lower quadrant pain. Okay, agreed. That is the, what are the differential diagnosis? Jefferson. Are you there, Jefferson? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, what are the different causes for acute right upper quadrant pain?
If it's gallbladder, it could be, as I said just now, okay. Biliary colic.
Yeah, biliary acute colic.
Cystitis.
Acute cholecystitis. Okay, anything else?
Cystitis.
Yeah, what?
Acute cholangitis.
Acute cholangitis, okay, can. Anything else?
It could be
you have to due think to of the all
acute pyelonephritis.
Acute pyelonephritis, yes, possible. Anything else? You have to think of all the organs there. You finish gallbladder. What about the liver?
Hepatitis.
Yeah, what? Hepatitis. Okay, hepatitis. Anything else? With fever?
With fever.
Abscess in the, that only will produce pain. Either pyogenic abscess or amoebic abscess. Hepatitis. All are causes in the liver. Causes in the gallbladder. Okay. And then causes in the bowel. Okay. It could be any tumor in the bowel. Carcinoma of the hepatic flexure. Yes, now you have covered all the organs. Okay, this is the differential diagnosis. Okay, let us see. This is, I have also given. This is biliary colic, cholangitis, cholecystitis. Yeah, we forgot acute pancreatitis. But usually acute pancreatitis, the pain will be in epigastric region. Gastritis also. Peptic ulcer disease, sometimes it will be in right upper quadrant also, especially if it is a duodenal ulcer. Okay, malignancy, okay. And another important thing is Fitzhugh-Kutty syndrome. What is it actually? Fitzhugh-Kutty syndrome is nothing but Neisseria gonorrhea. Gonorrhea. This is pelvic inflammatory, after pelvic inflammatory disease. It's common in female patient that forms what is called violin string adhesion between the liver and the diaphragm. You can see lot of violin string adhesion. This is because of gonorrhea in female patient. Yeah, it occurs very common in female patients only. And you all know myocardial infarction and lower lobe pneumonia can also produce, this pain abdomen anywhere. Okay. This is regarding the differential diagnosis. This you have to keep it in mind. Okay, this patient with her current history of severe persistent, this is very important, abdominal pain following ingestion of fatty food, nausea and vomiting associated with right upper quadrant tenderness to palpation, the etiology is most likely biliary in origin. The patient's prior history is consistent with biliary colic with a positive Murphy's sign. Positive Murphy's sign means inspiratory catch. That is what is called Murphy's sign. Patient is also having fever. The fever is called inflammatory marker. Both fever and leukocytosis will be there if it is acute cholecystitis. If it is biliary colic, the patient, they won't have fever, there won't be any leukocytosis also. Of course, this patient is also having tachycardia, okay, leukocytosis. Most likely, the diagnosis is acute cholecystitis. With a normal total bilirubin, alkaline phosphatase, cholidacolithiasis, and acute cholangitis are less likely. Okay, because there is no sign of any obstructive jaundice. And then normal amylase and lipase, that rules out gallstone pancreatitis also. Okay, right. Now, in the history, what you will ask in this patient? Can you tell me, suppose, no, yesterday you enacted only the history very well. Suppose, imagine that there is a patient with acute right upper quadrant pain. What you will ask in the history? Hello, who is the next? Jefferson, yeah, you have to answer. Jefferson? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what you will ask if you are encountering a case of right upper quadrant pain in history? So whenever you are encountering pain abdomen, you have to ask? I told you yesterday. What you have to ask if you are having pain in the abdomen?
We ask the site of the pain.
Yeah, what is that mnemonic? You just tell me the mnemonic. That's enough. You have to ask about the Socrates history, okay, regarding that, include everything about the pain.
Yes.
Okay, site of the pain, onset, everything you have to ask. Apart from this, what else you have to ask?
Yes.
How long it is lasting? Suppose if it is more than... what type of diet patient is taking? Anything else you want to ask? Associated symptoms? Apart from pain, what else?
Symptoms like
fever. Number one, you can ask whether patient is also fever. Having only pain or fever. If patient is having only pain, it is biliary colic. Apart from having pain, if the patient is also having fever, what is that? Pain plus fever, right upper quadrant. What is that? What is that? Just now I told you, if patient is also having inflammatory marker, what is that? If patient is having only pain, I told it is biliary colic. If patient is also having pain with fever, what is that? Acute cholecystitis. Suppose, okay, patient is also having jaundice. If patient is also having jaundice, pain, fever, plus jaundice. Now what is it? It's very easy surgery, just like mathematics. You have to understand how the patients are giving the history. This is very important. From history alone, okay, more than 70-75% of the cases, you can arrive at a correct diagnosis. If patient is having pain, fever, plus jaundice, what is this triad? Did you watch my video yesterday? I told you without watching the video,
yes,
you don't
sir.
Come to the class. Yeah, what is the triad then? What is this triad? Yeah, Chakov's triad. So what is your diagnosis then? If patient is also having these three things, what is your diagnosis? What is this?
Please.
Pain, fever, jaundice. What is your diagnosis? If it is pain alone, I told you it is biliary colic. Pain plus fever, acute cholecystitis. If it is pain, fever plus jaundice, what is the diagnosis? Cholangitis, acute cholangitis. That is the Chakov's triad. What is this? Did you watch the thing? I don't know. This is what you have to learn on your own. Don't expect me to teach everything. You have to learn on your own and come to my class. Here I am just reinforcing the knowledge which you have gained already by watching whatever I am sharing with you. Okay, the PowerPoint slides, the videos, everything you have to watch and come. You have to learn and you are supposed to answer. That is why I am telling you, you must watch and come to my class. Otherwise, it's not going to be very useful for you. Okay, that is regarding the history. Okay, and then the physical exam, and you told everything about the history taking. Physical exam, the most important sign is Murphy's sign. The patient will have what is called inspiratory catch. So what is the pathology or pathophysiology of this acute cholecystitis? Can you, the next student, who is the next student? Mohammed Firdas, are you there? Yeah, can you little bit louder, please? I am unable to hear you. What is the pathophysiology in acute cholecystitis? What happened? Etiopathogenesis. It is there in the slide itself. What is the cause for biliary colic? What is the cause for acute cholecystitis?
Acute cholecystitis, the inflammation of the gallbladder.
I am not asking you what is happening. I am asking you what is the cause for the inflammation. It is there in the slide, but why you are not answering, I don't know.
Because of the stone.
Yeah, stone, what happened?
Obstruction of the stone in the
gallbladder. Obstruction of stone in the gallbladder. What do you mean? I cannot understand what you are talking. Obstruction of what? Obstruction of gallbladder. Gallbladder is a big structure. Obstruction of what? Obstruction of what? Please, louder, please.
Obstruction of cystic duct.
Yeah, it is there here. You have to watch and you have to tell, it is there already. What type of obstruction? What is the difference between biliary colic obstruction and in acute cholecystitis? What is the difference? It is there already. What is the difference between, please understand what I am asking. What I am asking, please understand and then answer. What is the difference between the pathology in acute cholecystitis and biliary colic? Biliary colic, what happens? No, if you cannot understand or if you don't know, please tell me I don't know, so that I can go to the next student.
No, sure.
Okay, Kukilan. Kukilan Kumarasamy, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is the difference in pathology between acute cholecystitis and biliary colic?
In acute cholecystitis, the stone is lodged in the cystic duct.
Okay, what about biliary colic? There also stone is there. There also stone is obstructing the cystic duct. But what is the difference between these two? See this word. See what I have put here. The answer is already there. What is this? Every word is important. That is why you have to read not just like that. Carefully you have to read. I have put a word here. What is this? This is the answer. What? Louder, please. I couldn't understand what you are talking. What is the difference between biliary colic obstruction and acute cholecystitis obstruction of cystic duct?
Yeah, in biliary colic, the stone dislodges from the cystic duct.
See, in both, I am telling you repeatedly, in both condition, stone will obstruct the cystic duct. But what is the difference between biliary colic obstruction and acute cholecystitis? That is what I am asking, and I am showing you the answer also. If you have watched my video already, you must answer. And I am showing you the answer also here with the cursor. Okay, I am going to the next student. Gayatri Marimuthu, are you there?
Yes, sir.
What is the difference? Can you tell? This is the answer.
In cholecystitis, the obstruction of gallbladder is permanent, but then in biliary colic,
Please. It is not obstruction of the gallbladder. Obstruction of the cystic duct is permanent in which condition?
In cholecystitis.
Okay, in biliary colic?
It dislodges fall back before 3 hours.
So it is temporary obstruction. Okay. Yes. This is what you have to answer. Yeah, correct. Very good. So I am showing you the answer also here. Okay, right. What is the gold standard investigation? What will you do? Gayatri.
US of the abdomen.
Yeah, right upper quadrant ultrasound. So what you will see in that right upper quadrant ultrasound?
Can see
what are the three features?
Can see the posterior acoustic shadow, and then the gallbladder thickness will be more than 4 millimeters.
More than 4 millimeters. Then this is the gallstone. What is this you are seeing here? I am showing you with my cursor. What is this? What is this black area?
Posterior acoustic shadow.
Yeah, this is the posterior acoustic shadow. This is the gallstone. Here also you are seeing gallstone. This is the posterior acoustic shadow. What about the gallbladder wall thickness?
Should be more than 4 millimeters.
Now if you see it clearly, now you can see. See, the thickness of the wall is more than 4 millimeters. Apart from that, what is this black thing around the gallbladder? What is this? Here you are seeing some block. What is this? What is the third stage? Yeah.
Fluid.
Yeah, very good. That is the fluid. Correct. Very good. That is the pericholecystic fluid collection. So you have to get all the three criteria. Yeah, this is the ultrasound finding. Okay. Suppose if you, after ultrasound, you are not seeing any gallstone. So what is this investigation? What is this?
HIDA
is what? HIDA scan. Okay, this I didn't tell you. Hippuric immunodiacetic acid scan. This is nothing but you need not know about all those things. HIDA scan is a radioisotope. Okay. What you are seeing in this picture and what you are seeing in this picture? What is this? Answer also I am showing.
The tracer is have been taken up on the first.
Yeah. What is this? I am showing here. Gallbladder is taking up the tracer, radio tracer. So this is a normal person. It is not cholecystitis. Whereas here, what you are not seeing?
The gallbladder has not taken up this trace.
Gallbladder is not opacified. And what is this structure? What you are seeing here? What is this I am showing you? What is this?
The bile duct.
Bile duct. And what is this?
Small bile.
Bile duct is ending in duodenum. Be specific. This is duodenum. Okay, very good. This is what you have to know. Okay, I will go to the previous one. What is it? Okay. I have to reduce the size. Okay, this is what we were seeing. HIDA scan, I told you already. Then KUB is not helpful because only 10% of gallstones are radiopaque. 90% of the gallstones are radiolucent. Whereas this is just the reverse in case of urinary calculus. I mean, the urolithiasis, 90% of urinary calculus are radioopaque. Only 10% are radiolucent. So this you have to know. Okay, now this is the different causes or manifestation of gallstones. Okay, this is what is going to happen. The gallstone can present in so many ways. Okay, it can present as biliary colic. It can present as acute cholecystitis, which I told you already. It can also present as cholecystitis because one of the stones, gallstones in the gallbladder, can go to the CBD and it may lodge there. That is the condition called cholecystitis. After cholecystitis, because of stagnant bile. This bile, I mean the biliary duct, can go for inflammation, and that is what is called cholangitis. Sometimes this gallstone will come below and this obstruct the sphincter of OD or the common channel. So now what will happen? The bile cannot flow into the duodenum. Part of the bile will get reflex back into the pancreas. The pancreas will go for what is called pancreatitis. This is called gallstone pancreatitis. Sometimes there is a fistula formation between the gallbladder and the duodenum, and the gallstone will enter into the small bowel and it will go down, get stuck at ileocecal junction. And this condition is called gallstone ileus. The patient will present with features of small bowel obstruction, but the hallmark sign of gallstone ileus is presence of gas in the biliary tree, that is known as pneumobilia. If there is presence of gas in the bile duct, that is called pneumobilia. So these are manifestations of gallstone or how it can present. It can present as a gallstone ileus, it can present as a biliary colic. All these are possibilities. And then finally, Myrisi's syndrome. So you have to know all these things. The large gallstone impacted in the cystic duct in the Hartmann's pouch, and that will compress the common hepatic duct, not the common biliary duct, not CBD. It is CHD or common hepatic duct, and sometimes there may be a fistula formation between the gallbladder and the common hepatic duct. This is called cholecystocholidaco fistula. Whereas in gallstone ileus, the fistula is cholecystoduodenal fistula. Okay, you have to remember. I will ask you what fistula will form, what type of fistula you will get in gallstone ileus. That is cholecystoduodenal fistula. In Myrisi's syndrome, it is cholecystocholidacal fistula. Okay, please remember this. Okay, all these things are. What is the difference between biliary colic and acute cholecystitis? I think we have discussed, but okay, I will repeat once again. History, pain usually resolve within 3 to 4 hours in biliary colic. Symptomatic cholelithiasis mean biliary colic. Acute cholecystitis, it is unremitting pain. Pain is persistent. It is not relieved by anything. Okay, physical examination, only mild tenderness in biliary colic, whereas Murphy's sign or the inspiratory catch is positive in acute cholecystitis. Vital signs usually normal, whereas in acute cholecystitis you will have inflammatory markers like fever, tachycardia and elevated WBC. Okay, here normal WBC. And ultrasound findings, you are just seeing only gallstone. Okay, no thickening of gallbladder wall, no pericholecystic fluid collection, and no sonographic Murphy's sign. What do you mean by sonographic Murphy's sign? Instead of using your hand or fingers, you are using the probe, the ultrasound probe, to compress that area, and patient now also will have positive Murphy's sign. Because you are eliciting this Murphy's sign using the probe, ultrasound probe, it is called sonographic Murphy's sign. Please remember this. So now we have talked everything about what are the complications, what are the different methods of this thing, what are the investigations you have to do. Now only thing is you have to decide what treatment you are going to give. In acute cholecystitis, okay, this gallstone may be asymptomatic. If it is asymptomatic gallstone, you can do cholecystectomy, is not indicated, no surgery. But you have to tell your patient that patient is having gallstone. That is all you have to tell. If patient is having biliary colic, then you can go for elective lap cholecystectomy. If it is acute cholecystitis and if the patient has come to you within 3 days, okay, then you can go for urgent cholecystectomy. Suppose if it is acute cholecystitis, but patient has come to you after 48 hours, then you have to manage the patient conservatively to begin with. And then after 45 days, you have to do lap cholecystectomy or open cholecystectomy. If it is acute A calculus cholecystectomy, that means patient is critically ill, then you should not do major surgery. You can do what is called cholecystostomy. You have to put a tube inside into the gallbladder and drain the infected bile. That's all. When once patient becomes stable, then you can do elective cholecystectomy. If it is emphysematous cholecystitis, you have to do emergency cholecystectomy. If it is gallstone ileus, remove the large impacted gallstone from the terminal ileum, but don't do anything to the fistula between the gallbladder and the duodenum. You have to just remove the stone there in the terminal ileum in gallstone ileus. So this is the management for acute cholecystitis. I think you might have watched my video already. So I have given so many things, treatment algorithm, diagnostic algorithm, so many things I have given in the video, which I have shared with you. Post-operative relief, the patient present within the first week after cholecystectomy with abdominal pain, anorexia, consider a biloma. What do you mean by biloma? Biloma is nothing but collection of bile in the peritoneal cavity. This can happen in cystic duct stump leak. You are ligating the cystic duct. No, if this ligature or the clip slips, no, then there will be leakage of the bile that may collect in the peritoneal cavity, which can be easily corrected by doing an ERCP and putting a stent. But if it is a CVD injury, this is a major problem. See, cystic duct stump leak readily treated with ERCP and stenting of sphincter of Oddi. Suppose if it is CVD injury, that is a major problem, you can do either hepaticojejunostomy. Whatever duct is available, you have to join it with jejunum. Or, this is cholecystectomy. Hepaticojejunostomy means you have to join the jejunum to the liver. There is no proximal bile duct available. If enough proximal bile duct is available, cholecystectomy means the bile duct. You can go for cholecystectomy. Either you have to do hepaticojejunostomy or cholecystectomy. Both are very major surgery. So you have to be very careful. If you injure this is the most dangerous complication in cholecystectomy, CBD injury. So patient will sue you in the court. So you have to be very careful while doing cholecystectomy. Okay, additional important fact, there are some drugs which can dissolve the gallstone. This is called uricodeoxycholic acid, but unfortunately, this drug you have to give for prolonged time, maybe for six months you have to give. But the moment you are stopping the drug, again, it will recur. The gallstone will recur. So this is not very effective. And another thing is calcified gallbladder or porcelain gallbladder. If you are encountering, you have to do what is called prophylactic cholecystectomy, because majority of these porcelain gallbladder or calcified gallbladder will eventually end up in developing a cancer. Cholecystectomy is another congenital thing, biliary atresia also, which is not for you. This is a pure pediatric surgical problem. Cholecystectomy and biliary atresia occur in children. Yeah, it occurs in children. Hemolytic anemia in childhood, high risk for forming black pigment stone, if it is a hemolytic anemia. Gallbladder cancer can happen if there is chronic gallstone problem. Gallbladder polyp, if it is less than 1 centimeter, you need not do anything. So, you have to do what is called watchful waiting. If it is more than 1 centimeter, you have to suspect cancer. If it is more than 2 centimeter, most probably it is a cancer. Yeah, polyp in the gallbladder. This is how you have to, these are the different things you have to know. So here I am showing you the different varieties of gallstone. So what is this gallstone? what is this gallstone, this and this, okay. But in cholesterol, I have discussed some ratio regarding this one. What are the three materials that present in the bile? Okay, I am asking, I am going to the next student. Who is the next student? Jeevita. Jeevita, are you there?
Yes, Jeevita? Sir.
Yeah, what are the three elements present in the bile that will cause the gallstone, cholesterol stone?
Cholesterol, lecithin, yeah, and bile salts.
Yeah, very good. What is the normal ratio?
1:30.
So, suppose if it is going below 1:13, what will happen?
That's the ratio which causes the gallstone formation.
I didn't ask about gallstone. I asked about cholesterol stone.
Yeah, so the cholesterol gets precipitated in a crystal form.
Crystal, and then all these crystals will aggregate together. That is the cause for the cholesterol. Usually, cholesterol stone is single. That's why it's called cholesterol solitaire. Okay, what about this stone? What is this stone? Yes? Jeevita, you have to answer. What is this stone? Answer is also there in the slide.
Those are black stones caused by hemolytic disease.
Example, can you tell me a few examples of hemolytic disease? Like what? Hemolytic anemia, some anemias you can tell.
Sickle cell anemia.
Yeah, sickle cell. Okay, you have to tell so many things are there. Spherocytosis, ITP. So many things are there, hemolytic anemia. That will cause, what is the cause for the formation of black stone? What is liberated by excessive destruction of RBC? That is the cause for the black stone. Okay. What is this stone? This also, you finish all the varieties of stones. What is this stone? What is the other name? Here I have given brown stone, but there is another name for this. What is that? What is this stone? Yes?
I'm not sure.
What is this stone? Here I have shown brown stone, but what is this name of this stone? Mixture of this and this. What is that? Cholesterol plus black color. This is the mixture. So it is mixed stone. It is brown in color. There is a saying called gallstone is the tombstone. This is only for this stone. Okay? Gallstone is the tombstone erected in the memory of dead bacteria inside. This is Moynihan's aphorism. Aphorism means surgical proverb. Proverb, that's all. Just like a proverb. So this is the black area is the nidus, bacterial nidus or the dead bacteria. So after that, you will see concentric layer of one layer of cholesterol, another concentric layer of this pigment. Yeah, like that. Pigment, cholesterol, pigment like this. So that is why it's called mixed stone. Okay, this is about cholecystitis. You must know everything about this. Yeah, this we have discussed already. Okay, now I am going to the next case scenario. Okay, who is the next? Next, Ruvanka. Are you there, Ruvanka?
Yes, sir.
Can you please read this one?
A 40-year-old female presents with a 24-hour history of right upper quadrant pain and epigastric pain associated with nausea and vomiting. She has had a similar pain in the past, particularly after eating greasy foods. According to her family, over the last few hours, she has become slightly confused. Past medical history is negative. Physical exam, temperature of 102.5 degrees Fahrenheit. A heart rate of 110 beats per minute, respiratory rate of 16 per minute, and a blood pressure of 90/60. She is moderately tender in the right upper quadrant to deep palpation. She has slight scleral icterus and she has noted dark colored urine. The remainder of her abdominal exam is negative.
So with this six, yeah, okay, 1 minute. With this history, what do you think? What do you think? We will go to the lab and all afterwards. Well, merely by looking at the history, this patient is having, okay, number one, pain. Okay, patient is having pain. What else is having? Pain. Patient is also having
jaundice.
And what is this?
Pain that worsens on.
No.
Sorry,
what
temperature,
is this?
Fever.
So what is this rare?
Charcot's rare.
But this patient is also having mental confusion and hypotensive also. So what is that? Reynolds Pentad. Very good. What do you mean by Pentad?
Five factors. Yeah,
five things. Pain, fever, jaundice, hypotension, and altered mental status. This is what is called Reynolds Pentad. If patient is having only three things, that is pain, and then fever and jaundice, you have to tell patient is having only acute cholangitis. If patient is also having altered mental status and hypotension, then now it becomes suppurative cholangitis. So you have to know the difference between what is acute cholangitis and suppurative cholangitis. Acute cholangitis, Charcot's rare. Suppurative cholangitis, Reynolds Pentad. Yeah, please remember this. So now you read it. Can you please read it? Ruanka.
Laboratory values. Yeah. White blood cell
white
count.
Blood 15. Yeah, only you tell only this one. Okay. He not talk about the normal value and all. 15. Okay, then.
White blood count 15. Total bilirubin 4.0. ALP is 350. AST is 300. ALP 280. GGT is 330. Amylase is 100. And urine is positive for bilirubin.
Okay. So what is elevated in this one? Lab value. WBC is definitely elevated.
And bilirubin.
Bilirubin is elevated. And they have to give direct bilirubin and indirect bilirubin also. It is not correct that they have to give only total bilirubin. They must give direct and indirect also. Okay. Among the direct and indirect, which will be elevated in obstructive jaundice? Can you tell me?
Indirect.
You are telling exactly the wrong answer. Obstructive jaundice means direct bilirubin will be increased. What about alkaline phosphatase? Is it increase or what?
Yes.
Yeah, it is increased. At least some threefold it should increase alkaline phosphatase. But if alkaline phosphatase is increased, what else you have to do along with alkaline phosphatase? You must do GGT also. If both are increased, both GGT and alkaline phosphatase are increased, the pathology is hepatobiliary pathology. Maybe in liver, maybe in gallbladder. Suppose only alkaline phosphatase is increased, GGT is not increased. What is your inference? Can you tell me? This is very important. They ask in the last university exam for batch 40, the same question. Only alkaline phosphatase is increased, not GGT. What is your inference? Alkaline phosphatase will be increased in which other pathology? Okay, I will teach you. I think I haven't talked about this in detail there. Alkaline phosphatase will be increased not only in obstructive jaundice, it will be increased in any bony pathology. Yeah, it will be increased in pregnant women. It will be increased in leukemia. It will be increased in normal pediatric population also. So if alkaline phosphatase alone is increased, most probably it is from bone. Suppose apart from increased alkaline phosphatase, if GGT is also increased, then only it is obstructive jaundice. Yeah, that is the importance of GGT. Always you have to do GGT also along with alkaline phosphatase. Please remember this. They will be asking the same question in the exam. So amylase is normal here, but urine is positive for bilirubin. What type of bilirubin is positive? I will go to the next student. 1 minute. Prasanth Ravi. Prasanth Ravi?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What type of bilirubin you will get in the urine in case of arthritis jaundice?
Unconjugated?
Unconjugated. Unconjugated bilirubin. Yeah. What did you say? What type of bilirubin you will get in the urine in obstructive jaundice?
Unconjugated
bilirubin is what? Is it water soluble or fat soluble? How it is formed, unconjugated bilirubin? Where it is formed, how it is formed? Unconjugated bilirubin.
I'm not too sure, sir.
Okay, I go to the next student. Purnisa Durai Singham, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What is this bilirubin in urine? Conjugated or unconjugated?
Conjugated.
Why conjugated is present in urine, not unconjugated? Can you tell me? Unconjugated is what soluble? What? It is soluble in what? Unconjugated bilirubin. You know or you don't know the answer? Okay, I will tell you the answer. Unconjugated bilirubin is fat soluble, so it cannot be excreted in the urine. Whereas conjugated bilirubin is water soluble. Easily it will be excreted in the urine. Okay, only in obstructive jaundice you will get bilirubin in the urine. Suppose if it is a normal person, not obstructive jaundice, you are examining the urine. So what pigment will be present in the urine? Can you tell me? If you are going to answer it, I will be very, very happy. But unfortunately, all these things you will read in obstructive jaundice. Because this topic is overlap. This is not only abdominal pain, this is obstructive jaundice also. One of our, PBL class is obstructive jaundice. So I will share all those things, then you will be knowing. Okay, now I will answer. Yeah, maybe in the next week, you will be learning all those things. I think the next week topic is obstructive jaundice only. So urine is positive for bilirubin, but in a normal person's urine, if you examine the urine, patient will have what is urobilin will be positive. Urobilin, not bilirubin, in a normal person. Okay, right. Going to the next slide. These are the various causes for this we have discussed already, so I am not going to repeat it again. So I have talked about the Chagas triad. I talked about the Raynaud's pentad. Okay, what is this Tokyo guidelines? How many grades are there? Can you tell me in the next Sankara Devan Krishnamurti, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what are the Tokyo guidelines? How many grades are there?
So Tokyo guidelines census, they have three grades.
Three grades, okay. Okay, patients should have evidence of, what are the three grades?
The three grades are first grade, yeah, it should be mild.
Mild grade, yeah, mild one. Moderate and severe. Okay, moderate is patient is having, emphysematous gallbladder and localized abscess and all. In the severest form, what will be present? Patient may be in shock already. Okay, this is what is called Tokyo guidelines. Okay, I think I have Chagas triad. Repeatedly, I am telling these things. So you have to know this. Look for evidence of associated systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Elderly patient, okay, right, leave it. Etiology, I told you. Biliary obstruction with bacterial infection. Bacteria enter the bile, either via bloodstream from portal vein or retrograde from duodenum. Most commonly caused by gallstone obstruction of the distal CBD. Other things also can cause. Not only the cholelithiasis will cause ascending cholangitis, even any stricture of the CBD can cause ascending cholangitis. Any stagnant bile. Other causes are C, biliary stricture, cancer, parasites. All these things can cause ascending cholangitis. What are the parasites that can cause? Okay, this is not for you now. Okay, maybe I will discuss all these things next week, PBL, in obstructive jaundice. So this is suppurative cholangitis, mean it is acute cholangitis complicated by septic shock. Patient is going to go for septic shock. So now, today I will concentrate only on the pain abdomen, not on the obstructive jaundice, this thing. Patient will be having elevated WBC, alkaline phosphatase is increased. What is the importance? Can you tell me who is there? Sangaradevan, what is the importance of doing alkaline phosphatase along with GGT?
To rule out hepatobiliary obstruction, sir.
Pardon? Pardon?
To rule out hepatobiliary involvement.
Yeah, okay. Suppose if only alkaline phosphatase is increased, GGT is not increased. What is your inference?
There is no biliary obstruction in there is no obstruction in the liver.
Okay. So what could be the cause if only alkaline phosphatase is increased? I told you. What pathology? Where else, apart from biliary pathology, where else this alkaline phosphatase will increase? Where else it will increase? Just now I told you various causes. I told you leukemia, I told pregnant woman, I told pediatric patient, I told. Which other pathology? Only alkaline phosphatase is increased. What is the pathology?
The bone.
Bone, yeah, bone pathology. Maybe a bone secondary or any bony pathology. Even osteomyelitis, you will get elevated alkaline phosphatase. Ultrasound is diagnostic. You will see dilated CBD, okay? Management is little complicated. If it is just ascending cholangitis, you have to treat it with, still you can treat with just antibiotic. Suppose if it is a suppurative cholangitis, that is a problematic, I think I will discuss the treatment for suppurative cholangitis next week when I am going to talk about the obstructive jaundice, because that is little bit complicated. I have to talk so many things. You have to admit the patient in ICUC, and then you have to decompress it with ERCP. If ERCP fail, you have to do PTBD. You have to read all these things. What is PTBD? Percutaneous transhepatic biliary drainage. Or open surgery also you can do. If both the things are not possible, then you have to do open surgery. Cholecystectomy also must be done after sepsis resolves. Okay. The diagnosis of acute cholangitis may be missed in elderly patient. Okay. Think sclerosing cholangitis if patient is also having symptoms of IBD. Okay. These are all the things you have to know. This is what is Chaka's triad. I am just repeating the same thing. Yeah. Okay. This you can just go through this one. Okay. Now I am going to the next student. Who is that? Sonia Chitrakaran.
Yes,
Sonia Chitrakaran. Are you there? What is this picture? What is this picture? What is the finding? Can you tell me?
It's ERCP.
Okay, wait. Yeah, now you can see it very well. Yeah, what is the finding you are having here? Yes? What is this?
Is it the ERCP stone removal using the Dormia basket?
No, I am asking you the finding here. You have to tell there are filling defect in the common bile duct. That's all you have to tell. So why you are telling it is ERCP? I am telling it is MRCP. Why you are telling it is ERCP?
Hello?
Not sure, because you are seeing an endoscope. What is ERCP? At least tell, expand ERCP at least. What is ERCP?
Endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography.
Okay, so that is why the first thing is endoscopy. That is what you are seeing here. If you are doing an MRCP, you won't see the endoscope there. So this is choledocholithiasis. Okay, what is this investigation? What is this investigation, Sonia? Yeah, it is there already. What is this?
EUS.
What do you mean by EUS? That is why
endoscopic ultrasound.
Yeah, very good. Endoscopic ultrasound. See, this is the endoscope. Around that, okay, ultrasound. It's a circular ultrasound. You are seeing the CBD. This is the CBD. Inside the CBD, you are seeing the stone also. Posterior to the CBD, you are seeing portal vein also. So you can make out the stone in the CBD by doing endoscopic ultrasound also. Okay, now I am going to the next student, Kiran. Are you there, Kiran?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
What is this one? What is this one? I told this one.
PTCBD is percutaneous transhepatic biliary drainage. So
you
they
do this for treatment of which pathology you do this?
If there's any blocked bile duct, we can open that up.
No. Wrong. Not for bile duct block. This is only for a specific pathology we do this PTBD. What is that? I told just now. But I told you that I will discuss it in detail next week. What topic I told you that I will discuss next week in detail?
Obstructive jaundice.
Okay, obstructive jaundice. In that, what complication is very dangerous, I told you. Suppurative cholangitis. In suppurative cholangitis, what you will have? Findings. Five things. What is that called? In suppurative cholangitis, you will have Reynolds-Pented. Yeah, Reynolds-Pented. So see, PTBD means you have to, through the skin, this is a needle, through the skin, through the liver, you have to puncture the dilated CBD, dilated intrahepatic ducts, you have to puncture so that the bile will get drained through this. That is what is called PTBD, but don't worry, I'll be talking about it later while I'm going to discuss about the obstructive jaundice. This also, next week, I will talk in elaborately regarding the stone. This is the endoscope. This is a sphincterotome. And they are cutting this one, sphincter. This is called sphincterotomy. Then they are putting a Damia basket inside, catching hold of, this is one stone, this is another stone. You catch hold of this stone and remove it. Yeah, this, all these things I will be talking later. This is a case of, this is a choledocholithiasis. This is a CA head of the pancreas here. But here they are putting what is called inside a metallic stent they are putting. Their aim is, because no, this tumor will compress the CBD, patient will go for obstructive jaundice. In order to relieve the jaundice, you put an internal stent here so that it cannot compress, because it's a metallic stent. It cannot compress the CBD. That is the idea of putting the stent inside so that patient will be relieved of obstructive jaundice. Okay, don't worry, I will be discussing all these things in detail later in your class. Yeah, in next week. Okay, I am closing this one. Probably like yesterday, okay, I will go to the acute cholecystitis. Yesterday I said the same video, same PowerPoint presentation by the Association for Surgical Educator. Okay, this is not my slides. This is a teaching slide prepared by the Association for Surgical Education by American College of Surgeons. Okay, these are all very good teaching slides. That's why 41-year-old woman in ER presenting with 12 hours duration of progressively worsening right upper quadrant discomfort or pain associated with nausea and vomiting. She also reports chills also. See, this patient is having chills, means he is having pain also. So it is 12 hours already. So it cannot be biliary colic. It must be acute cholecystitis. What are the points you will ask the history? Whenever you are encountering an abdominal pain, you have to ask the Socrates history, and then what is the duration of the pain, associated symptoms and signs like fever, jaundice, vomiting, all these things you have to ask. Yeah? Okay. And you have to ask, this is what you are supposed to ask in history. Characterization of symptom. Temporal sequence means timing, relieving and aggravating factors, associated symptoms and signs, which I told you already. Pertinent and past medical history, review of system, medications taken, family history and social history. So this patient is telling he is having both epigastric and right upper quadrant pain radiating to the back, that is called Bova's sign. Nausea and bilious vomiting is there. Pain is constant in nature. Say, it is not relieved by anything. Unrelenting pain. Symptoms started 40 minutes after eating a meal, especially a fatty meal. So relieving, nothing makes the pain better. Nothing relieves the pain. Breathing and movement is aggravating the pain. See, all these things you have to ask in the history. Associated signs and symptoms, similar symptoms in the past, yeah, but never lasted long. Our patient, she told, several attacks, but just 1 hour only, not more than 3 hours. Denies history of any jaundice. So jaundice and fever also you have to ask. Pertinent medical history, patient is an obese patient and multi-para. Hysterectomy was done, previous surgery. Review of system, no change in bowel habits, no weight loss, no bleeding, bright red blood per rectum. BR, BPR means bright red blood per rectum. No melina, no diarrhea. Okay. Medications, no medications. No known drug allergy, NKDA. Relevant family history, mother had cholecystectomy. Relevant social history, patient is a non-smoker, non-alcoholic or teetotaler. She is a divorcee. Okay. What is your differential diagnosis? We have already discussed about so many differential diagnoses, so I am not going to do it. So patient is, now the examination finding also, they are telling temperature is elevated, heart rate is also elevated, but BP is normal. Respiratory rate also slightly increased. Appearance, he is an obese woman in mild distress. Relevant exam finding, HEENT, no icterus, no jaundice, but there is dry mucous membrane because patient is vomiting, he has gone for dehydration. Chest is normal, CVS is normal, abdomen soft, not distended, right upper quadrant tenderness with positive Murphy's sign, that is respiratory, inspiratory catch. Bowel sounds normal, no palpable masses. Neuromuscular, skin, genitorectal, everything is normal. But whenever you are doing an abdominal examination, you must do a rectal examination also, digital rectal. So now you have to do all these lab tests. Yeah, CBC, electrolyte, liver function, amylase, all these things you have to do. Okay, this is the report. Hemoglobin is 13, hematocrit. WBC is 13,000. LFT, bilirubin is 1.8. AST is 110. Alkaline phosphatase is 170. All are within normal limits only. Amylase, lipase, everything is normal. So what lab points find out, cardiac, pulmonary, urinary shows highly unlikely. Patient has no pancreatitis also because amylase and lipase are normal. Elevated WBC is because of there is some infection. Mild elevation of liver function is okay, acceptable. So now mostly it is acute cholecystitis. So what you have to do, you have to admit the patient, start IV fluid, keep the patient NPO, and you have to do ultrasound. Before that, you have to do an abdominal X-ray also. Any severe abdominal pain, you have to rule out pneumoperitoneum. That you have to do, and then it should be followed by ultrasound of the right upper quadrant. Okay, this is the X-ray. Here you are seeing all the X-rays. acute abdominal series, it is normal. No gas under diaphragm. This is just an ileus here. That's all. Abdominal series is negative. So right upper quadrant ultrasound, presence of gallstone or sludge, pericholecystic fluid, I told you, gallbladder wall thickening of more than 4 millimeters, presence of sonographic Murphy sign, intrahepatic or extrahepatic ductal dilatation, and other pathologies also you can make out. That is why ultrasound is the gold standard investigation. See here, you are seeing the sludge here. So it is emphysematous gallbladder. So they immediately did surgery for this patient, emergency cholecystectomy, and they are doing this is what is called intraoperative cholangiogram. If you want to rule out any stone in the common bile duct before doing the cholecystectomy, while you are doing it, you have to cannulate the cystic duct, inject the dye and take the picture. Nowadays we are not doing it very frequently because we have got excellent ultrasound facilities nowadays. While I was doing my post graduation, no, every cholecystectomy cases we used to do what is called intraop cholangiogram, because we at that time we were not having the ultrasound facility those days. This is another case. This is the stone. Here also, I'm just rushing it through. HIDA scan, when will you do HIDA scan? Only if you are suspecting A calculus cholecystitis. You all know that. This is the same thing. The gallbladder is not opacified. So this is a case of A calculus cholecystitis. If it is A calculus cholecystitis, the management is cholecystostomy and not cholecystectomy. You have to drain the infected bile by putting a tube inside the gallbladder. That's all. So this is not for you. This is for CT scan indication. Here you are seeing gas in the gallbladder wall. This is emphysematous gallbladder. Emphysematous cholecystitis. This is the gallbladder thickness. So different CT scan you are seeing it. They are just the same thing they are telling. That's all. Please be there. I'm coming there. Okay, students. Now it is your time to ask me question. Clear your doubt by asking questions. Yes. Any questions from anyone? No question.
Sir.
Yeah.
For the radioisotope scan. I saw one of your slides. You had PPDA. What is PPDA?
This is different chemical, that's all. Both are radioisotopes. You need not remember. I told you the hippuron immunodiacetic acid. Like that, PPDA also some chemical. But this is radioactive element. That's all you have to remember. That's all. You can do HIDA scan or PPDA scan. That's all. Only thing you have to bother about is whether the gallbladder is getting opacified or not. What is the indication for isotope scan, HIDA scan? When will you do?
Usually in A calculus.
If it is A calculus or equivocal ultrasound finding, very good. Suppose if you are getting HIDA scan, if your patient is having A calculus cholecystitis, how will you manage them? Because your patient is critically ill. So what will you do? Will you do
cholecystectomy?
No. Okay. What treatment you will do? You have to remove that infected bile, no? I told you just now. You should not do cholecystectomy. But what else you have to do? You have to do cholecystostomy. That means you have to put a tube inside the... Through the skin, you put a tube in the gallbladder so that you can remove all the infected bile from the gallbladder. Temporarily, you are doing it. This is not the correct treatment because you want to, avoid this sepsis, septic shock. Patient is very critical. He cannot withstand a major surgery. That's why we are doing cholecystostomy alone. to tide off that crisis. That's all. Okay, right. Any other question from anybody?
Sorry, sir. One more question, sir. What is elective? When do you do elective cholecystectomy?
One minute. Elective cholecystectomy is for biliary colic. Biliary colic patient, you need not do emergency surgery. Yeah, because there is no infection, no urgency. Suppose if it is acute cholecystitis, two things. If patient is coming to you within 3 days, go for straight away you can do emergency cholecystectomy. If patient is going to come to you after 3 days, even now you have to manage them conservatively. You have to do what is called cool down the patient by giving antibiotic first. If they are going to come after 3 days, because there will be lot of infection, lot of edema in the gallbladder. So, if you try to do the surgery, you may injure some vital structures like CBD injury. So, in order to avoid that, initially you go for conservative treatment, and then after 45 days, you can do cholecystectomy electively. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay. Any other question by anyone?
No, sir.
Yeah, no questions. Okay, no. In that case, okay, tomorrow morning, the same. Yeah, yes. Any other question?
Yes, sir, a question.
No other question. Okay. So, sir, tomorrow morning, you have a question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah, please ask me.
Yeah. In case if we do cholecystostomy in patients with A calculus cholecystitis,
yeah.
Do we have to do cholecystectomy after that?
Yeah, if it is A calculus cholecystitis, you have to do, you have to temporarily only you are doing cholecystostomy. I told you, it is only to tide off that crisis. You have to do cholecystectomy afterwards, after some time. You have to treat the patient with cholecystostomy and antibiotic. When once patient is not stabilized, hemodynamically stabilize the patient, and then you must do cholecystectomy. That is the correct treatment. Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Cholecystostomy is only a temporary procedure. Yeah. Okay. So tomorrow morning, the same time, 9:30, we are meeting, and tomorrow's topic is epigastric pain. Please read. Watch my video and read the PowerPoint and come to the class. Then only you will enjoy. I will be asking so many questions like that. It will be very useful. Please go and read once again the same topic. So I told you this week, the theme of this week, my teaching is abdominal pain. Even Thursday also, I am going to talk the same thing. So my aim is all of you should become very confident about abdominal pain. Yeah? Whichever area it may be. It may be right lower quadrant, right upper quadrant, epigastric, or left lower quadrant. In short, it is acute abdomen. That is what, in summary, we are going to do it on in our PBL this week on Thursday afternoon. Okay? Please read and come to my class. Okay. Thank you very much. Let us meet tomorrow morning at 9:30, the same time. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.